I wanted to sort of create as you know, as authentic of a container for everyone to be able to speak their truth. And hopefully, you know, as truth comes through, truth speaks how it speaks.
Why this particular story when there are so many to choose from, I would imagine, even centered in Baltimore?
So I felt like there was an opportunity for a microcosmic story to mirror a macrocosmic sort of impact that we really needed to look at. I wasn't sure that was going to happen, but I felt that there was a possibility for that. And I thought it was an important case because this was a Black man and he was law enforcement. And that's an intersection that we haven't seen, you know, or we haven't, I'm sure it's out there, but we haven't seen a lot of narratives around, you know, what happens when a Black man who's a law enforcement officer dies and the public thinks, you know, one of the theories is that it could be at the hands of his quote unquote brethren or the police.
I hope that this film gives the family some closure and some respect to this police officer whose character was so questioned and criticized even when he was, you know, 6 feet under. And I wondered if that was an intention for you, I guess, is the question.
This is a really tricky film because I didn't know what we were going to uncover, right? But I did want to honor the family and Detective Souter. They were so certain of his character that they decided to be involved in the film. Yeah. And I think that speaks to the family and that speaks to Sean. I am not in the business and this is no disrespect to reality, but reality TV has a very different sort of barometer, you know, and this is not about gotcha moments, so to speak. It's about really, you know, the truth. And I think they understood that. And they also understood that there was a larger context here that was just as important as who killed their loved one.
Yeah.
And they, I think by the time I had come around, I believe had gotten a sense that there could have been something bigger at play. Cause now they didn't know who to trust. I am just blessed and honored that they decided to trust me to the degree that they did, to just use this as a vehicle to get their voice out. At least they got to say some things, you know, mm-hmm. And that's what I wanted to sort of create as authentic of a container for everyone to be able to speak their truth. And hopefully, you know, as truth comes through, truth speaks how it speaks. And, you know, we gather meaning from that individually in the audience, in the way that we do. And together, I think, you know, those questions that we receive from the material that we answer within us and then discuss, that actually becomes a part of the larger work.
Do you think that the world, do you think that the country is finally hearing and finally paying attention to the corruption that continues to plague all police departments, but especially the Baltimore Police Department?
You know, I know it might be hard to believe for some folks, you know, but I do believe there is attention being paid. I mean, there's so much media out here around police corruption. You know, I've never told anyone this story, but I remember when my father got out of the service, he retired back in the late 60s, in our town, he was one of the first Black guards at the jail. And he got into a lot of trouble when he saw police brutality, like brutality within the jail. And he started reporting it. Eventually he got fired. But this was something that was, you know, in my world in a way, you know, gosh, I hadn't thought about this in years. And no one knew about this. You know, my father was giving me these stories, but folks, you know what I mean? And there were people listening, but compared to what, you know, the people of my father's generation had to endure and you know, in the ways they weren't heard. And now I'm saying, yeah, there has been some evolution for sure.